In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, the chief guest of the evening, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri, Dr. Zakir Naik, Mr. Chaman Bhai Vora, Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. On behalf of the organizers, the Indian Vegetarian Congress, the Islamic Research Foundation, and the Rushaf Foundation, I welcome all of you today to this morning's unique program, a public dialogue on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? It is being held in a spirit of friendship and understanding each other's viewpoints. I, Dr. Muhammed Naik, am the coordinator for this dialogue. Hence, I occupy a neutral position. It is my onerous duty to ensure a fair and proper conduct of this meeting. Therefore, I would request both our speakers as well as the audience to maintain due decorum for a healthy and lively debate, as well as a dialogue. Now we would have the past president of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, Mr. Jayantilal R. Doshi, welcoming and introducing the chief guest of the evening, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi. Mr. Jayantilal Doshi.
Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, he is a very senior advocate in the Supreme Court of India and leading tax expert of Mumbai. His activity in economics field inside ex-president of Indian Mercantile Chambers and active members of chairman of many other institute, trade and industrial body. In professional field, he was president of Chambers of IT Consultant and Vice President of IT Tribunal and Bar Association. In political field, he is traders of Maha Pradesh Congress Committee, BRSCC. He is also chairman and director of many public limited company, Reliance and Dana Bank. In education field, he was location of Master's degree in lower and Bombay University. He regularly continues article of various submitted in different papers and journalists. He has addressed a member of senior and meeting of Rotary, Lions Club, etc., and Air India and Doordarshan, etc. Thank you.
Now we have Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, President of the Rushaf Foundation, presenting mementos to our chief guest, as well as garlanding him on behalf of the organizers. Now we have our chief guest, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, addressing our audience collected here today. Mr. Y.P. Trivedi.
Dr. Zakir Naik, Mr. Rashmi Zaveri, Dr. Muhammed Naik, Dr. Dhanraj Salecha, Chimanlal Vora, and friends. Before I give my introductory speech, I have been told and I think I would like to repeat and say with great firmness that one of the greatest friend and the greatest enemy of our civilization is the cellular phone. And all those who have got cellular phones, it's a great friend, you know, when you are in absolute necessity, and when you are in a meeting, it's a great enemy. So I would request all those with cellular phones, please switch off the phone and do not disturb, because it disturbs the train of thinking of those who are speaking, on those who are attending and other listening very attentively. Friends, I welcome all the speakers and all of you here to this very healthy debate which is taking place. I believe that this should be the beginning of similar debates which should take place in the times to come. This debate or discussion or the clearing house of mind is probably in the best traditions, both of the Hindu civilization as well as of Islam. In our mythology and our history, we have such instances of such debates taking place in the courts of kings like Janak, when people from various shades of thoughts, because Hinduism was never following one particular pattern of thinking. There was Bhakti Marg, there was non-dualism, there was Advait Marg, there was Charvaks who did not believe in any god. So all of them, Janak king, King Janak, used to assemble them, provoking them to debate, not trying to influence anybody, but inviting the thoughts and then leaving the debate to the people at large to make up their own mind. So that was the tradition of our Hindu religion in this land of India. That was also the tradition of Islam. In the immediately succeeding years after the demise of Prophet Muhammed, Islam was a religion, Arabia was the place which was the place of learning, logics, mathematics, astronomy. All this was being discussed, and the great scholars of Arabia imbibed the thought, made inquiries, and transformed that knowledge thereafter to the Western world. According to me, the Renaissance movement in Europe owes its origin to the thinking of these Arab thinkers who were great stalwarts in their own time. We very often associate Arabia with thinking about Arabian Nights. But let me tell you that apart from the strides which they made in the field of fiction and some of the most imaginative fictions, at the same time in the field of science, technology, thinking, logics, mathematics, they made great strides. That is why today also, in spite of all the achievements, the West is still talking about the numerals as the Arabic numerals. And this is how Islam also in those days used to think openly. That tradition has been continued, because I believe in the realm of King Akbar. He also used to call people from all religions, even the Christians who came at that time. They landed on the shore of India. They were also called, and they were asked to explain what are the tenets of the religion. So this sort of healthy debate is something which is an absolute necessity for the development of any cultured, civilized, and tolerant society. Dr. Vora said that he's neutral. Let me tell him and all of you, I am also neutral. If I would not have been neutral, I would not have been made the chief guest. And I do not wish to desire to make any final comment on the subject. But one school of thought I would like to narrate here, which I read at some place, that all those animals in nature who are grass eaters, the animals which are thriving on leaves, they have got bovine teeth. They do not have canine teeth. all those animals which are eating flesh, meat eaters, they have got canine teeth, what we call rakshi. Human being is the one species which has got both bovine teeth as well as canine teeth. So it is very likely that nature wanted this species to survive. Nature considered that this species, human beings, are the most important species which should be there in this world. They should try to contribute. They should try to carry my message and take it further. So they wanted, the nature probably wanted, this species to survive under all circumstances. Nobody can deny that the early Homo sapiens or Homo erectus, they are all flesh eaters. At that time, there was no agriculture. If you look at the evolution, as we now learn from science, it is only the advance of civilization that people started taking to agriculture. When they started taking to agriculture and started growing corns, some of them became vegetarian, some of them remained non-vegetarian, some of them became the mixture of both. They also took vegetarian as well as non-vegetarian. And most of the non-vegetarian people today also eat vegetarian food as a part of their diet. I believe that in this aspect, when you are talking whether it is permitted or prohibited, we are talking about permission or prohibition by the religion. In this one aspect, Dr. Naik, I would probably like to differ from you. I believe that it is not the function of religion to tell us what we should eat and what we should not eat. Religion should try to purify our soul, purify our conscience, talk about good behavior, lead us to the path of God. What we should eat, what we should not eat is something which the doctors should tell us. The nutrition experts should tell us. It is not the function of the religion to say you shall not eat garlic, you shall not eat onions, you shall not eat ginger. Because this is something, if subsequently the nutritional experts tell us that this is something which is very good for your health, which is very good for your survival, which is very good for you to fight your diseases, then certainly it has to be taken. Because these are the subjects in modern day science. We have to grow up. We have to think in terms of what is lying ahead of us. We are entering now the next millennium, 21st century. So much is expected from us. Today only I was reading in one of the magazines about the forecast of Nostradamus. And Nostradamus thinks that this particular country, which is surrounded on three sides by sea, that one country will come on the top of the world. And are we going to go into the top of the world, become a superpower, by just clinging ourselves to some of the outdated notions? For example, yesterday, so many people migrated from this country. I was wondering in the heart of my heart, what is it? There is no scientific explanation. All throughout, all people with any basis of logic, all people who knew something about science, they were saying nothing will happen whether eight planets come in one line or they go zigzag. Nothing is going to happen. But then all types of talks were there. Alang, which was our largest shipyard, that was completely forsaken and completely deserted. I was told that for rushing to Rajasthan, I don't understand why people from Rajasthan are so panicky. The Marwaris left everything, came here and made an empire. And the same Marwaris, thinking the eight planets are there, they ran away. I was told 2,500 rupees were paid for a bus ticket for going back to Rajasthan. And nothing happened. So what is very important for all of us, if this country has to go further, if we as a nation has to make our mark, and probably the destiny is before us, we can reach great strides. 21st century, as I've always been saying, belongs to India and Pakistan. Both of them, when they will come nearer and nearer, they will be able to become the leaders of the 21st century. And if that is going to happen, then let me tell you, we will have to get out of these old dogmas. What we should eat, we should not eat, the doctors should tell us. If a new scientific discovery is made, and I've been asked that I should eat tomatoes because it fights the cancerous growth, then I must eat tomatoes, irrespective of what my religion tell me. So I think let us go to the scientists. Let us develop for ourselves a modern mind, a scientific approach. Then I think today or tomorrow, the whole world is before us. I don't want to comment on the or trespass on the domain of the speakers. With these introductory remarks, I am once again trying to point out I am absolutely neutral, and I would like to hear the views of the learned people who have made research on the subject. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Trivedi. Now we have brief introductions of each of the speakers before we get into the mode of formal dialogue program. We have Mr. Chamanbhai Vora, Senior Vice President of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, to introduce Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri.
Well, today I feel very happy to introduce our President, Sri Rashmibhai Zaveri, President of the Indian Vegetarian Congress. I think this public dialogue will become very, very interesting looking to the introductory speech given by our Chief Learned Guest Vice P. Trivedi. So let us hope for the very good dialogue. Now, Rashmibhai Zaveri is a chartered accountant by profession. He is having his own firm, Rashmi Zaveri and Company. They are very well reputed in the field of, as far as the corporate section sector is concerned. And he is a very good speaker as far as the religious speeches are concerned. He is a master of many of the religious philosophies. He is a very active member of the Chartered Accountant Society. He himself is the member of the Bharat Jain Mahamandal. He is the founder president of the Forum of Jain Intellectuals, one of the very prominent institutions as far as the Jain people are concerned. And he is very well connected with the Kala Gurjari also. Though he is very young, at the age of 63, he is very energetic. And he looks forward always to this type of dialogues, and today's dialogue is really a very good one. And I, especially before, by giving the introduction of Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, I would like to thank our chief guest as well as our Dhanraji and our Zakir Naik Sahab for having a very good dialogue, whether by principle a human being can take or should not take the vegetarian and non-vegetarian foods. Thank you very much.
Mr. Ashraf Mohammadi, to introduce Dr. Zakir Naik.
Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik, 33 years, is the president of the Islamic Research Foundation, Mumbai. Though a medical doctor by professional training, he is renowned as a dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir removes misconceptions about Islam on the basis of Quran, Hadith, and religious scriptures of various other religions. He also uses reason, logic, and modern scientific facts to remove the misconceptions about Islam. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 3 years itself, he has delivered more than 300 public talks worldwide. Dr. Zakir also appears on various international TV and satellite TV channels throughout the world. He has also participated in various symposias and such dialogues with prominent personalities of various faiths.
I have been asked by many persons, why are we having this dialogue, this topic, these speakers only? I hereby clarify. Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, president of Rushab Foundation, once visited the Islamic Research Foundation office about 1.5 months ago. He presented the Islamic Research Foundation kindly with a set of literature favoring vegetarianism. These included quotations from major world religions, which included quotations also from the Quran and sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which according to him indicate that non-vegetarian food is prohibited for human beings. After some discussions, Mr. Salecha proposed that a public dialogue be held at Patkar Hall between Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri, President of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, and Dr. Zakir Naik, President of Islamic Research Foundation, on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? This would, in turn, enable the audience at large to know the different viewpoints of both the speakers and form their own judgment. Both the speakers agreed to the same. Just about 5 days back, that is this Tuesday, I met Mr. Zaveri, and he requested that both the speakers in their talk refrain from speaking on other religions except their own. Dr. Zakir, though being very ardently in the field of comparative religion, reluctantly agreed. Therefore, as far as the religious points are concerned in the talk and response of our speakers, Mr. Zaveri will speak only from the Jain viewpoint unless compelled otherwise. Similarly, Dr. Zakir will speak only from the Islamic viewpoint unless compelled otherwise. This, in brief, is the clarifying background to the dialogue. The format for the dialogue will be, as agreed to and decided fair by the speakers, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri will first address us for 50 minutes on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Then Dr. Zakir Naik will make his presentation for 50 minutes on the same topic. This would be followed by a response session in which Mr. Zaveri will respond for 15 minutes to the matter presented by Dr. Zakir. Similarly, Dr. Zakir too would then respond for 15 minutes to the matter presented by Mr. Zaveri. When 5 minutes are left for the conclusion of the talk or the response time, I would put before each speaker a plate saying 5 minutes left, in which time they are expected to conclude. Lastly, we would have the question and answer session in which the audience may pose questions to each of the speakers alternately on the question mics provided in the auditorium. Written questions on slips of paper would be given secondary preference if time allows us. Now, I would request our first speaker, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri, to present his address. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri.
Before I start my talk, I'm really very happy that this atmosphere of brotherhood, it has really moved me. And I will request Dr. Zakir Naik to come forward and let's have a Gale Lagja scene. The chief guest of this morning, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, President of Rushab Corporation, Sri Dhanraj Salecha, the learned speaker, Dr. Zakir Naik, the expert commentator,
and the coordinator, Dr. Mohammed Naik, Vice President of IBC, Sri Chaman Bhai Vora, other dignitaries on and off the dais, my friends, brothers and sisters. First of all, I must acknowledge the dedication, the sincerity with which all the three organizations, particularly Islam Research Foundation, has taken pains in arranging this lecture. I don't mind and I don't hesitate in saying the entire credit goes to IRF. Friends, the topic today is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Any argument or any statement for that matter is always to be considered from a relative point of view. There cannot be any absolute truth, there cannot be any absolute statement that it is 100% prohibited or 100% permitted. So friends, let's see, as very rightly put in by Mr. Trivedi, who started the ball rolling, that we'll not speak only from religious point of view. Religious has to enter. You can't divorce it from today's subject. But I would like to speak on this topic, that non-veg food is prohibited for human being from various angles. For example, geographical reason, historical reason, moral, ethical and religious reason, economical, environmental and ecological reasons, natural reasons and psychological reasons, and above all, medical reasons. It's a fact now well established that our actions are controlled by our thoughts. What we think, we act. And our thoughts are controlled by our diet. As we eat, so we behave. And that's why the topic is very important, that we should choose our diet in such a way that our thinking is positive. The word positive will include everything. And believe me, friends, not only all the religions, but the medical science has now proved that the food that we take, it definitely influences our thinking and so our behavior. Friends, there was a time when there was no alternative available, as Mr. Trivedi rightly put. There were places on this world, and there are even now places where there is no availability of vegetation. It is simply not possible because of the extreme circumstances. But now the world has progressed so much that there is a very advanced system of transportation which is available to us. And any type of commodity, including food, can be transported from one part of the globe to another without any problem. Now that when we have got alternatives, we have to think about this, which alternative is better from all the angles that which I have described earlier. And that's why, friends, I am now coming to my topic proper, that non-veg food is not permitted now at this point of time, not only for India, but for other countries of the world also. First of all, I will say that all Indian philosophies have stated that we should not harm any living being, not only the living beings that we can see, but also those living beings which we cannot see, which are in air, fire, water, etc. But always there is a limit. It's very difficult for a human being to refrain from total ahimsa, total hinsa or violence because of his needs. So that is why Lord Mahavir stated that at least you limit the essential killings, but absolutely no killing for your own selfish motive or for your own needs of hunger, etc. And that is why under Jainism and most of the Indian philosophies, non-veg food is totally prohibited. Now this is a religious aspect. I will not go very deep into it. But the psychological aspect, the effect that non-veg food has on our thoughts and deeds, that is the most important part. The learned authors, I will not now quote the names of the books and authors because that will take time. But I have got all the authorities with me. It is said that veg diet reduces needless suffering in the world and also preserves our ecosystem. See, when I talk about alternative, you look here, you look at the wild animals who stay in jungle. Those who are carnivorous, they will restrict themselves to meat eating only. But those animals which are herbivorous, they will never go for meat eating. Only human being is such because of some false notions, I will say. The human being has been both a carnivorous and herbivorous. As I said, if alternative is available, why should we go for unnecessary killing? The basic principle underlying this theory is non-violence, love, and compassion for animals, birds, fish, etc. Because flesh food falls in not essential category, while vegetarian food comes under essential category. Psychologically also, cruelty, instant impulses, urges, basic animal instincts, impatience are all the necessary consequences of flesh food. By eating animal flesh, man will ingest all the animal instincts, the four basic animal instincts of food, fear, possessiveness, and reproduction. These are there in men, I don't say no. But they are the basic instincts. We have got a reasoning mind. We can rise above these basic instincts. We can control our impulses and urges and become, then only we can become super animals or super beings. Otherwise, human being and animals, there is no difference at all. But man has additional quality called reasoning mind, which is blunted by the influence of flesh, food, and man becomes more like animal. The scientific reason for this is that flesh is an integral part of animal body. It is full of tamasic value. There are three types of values, tamasic, rajasic, and sattvic. Tamasic, in short, is the brutal sense or brutal instincts of animal. A man becomes more like an animal, he is callous, he is cruel, he is ignorant, if he is eating the food that is the part of the bodies of the dead animals. The crime rate is higher. Aggression is the natural consequences of flesh food. It distorts the thinking and reasoning. It is not only a problem by itself, but it creates many other problems like increase in crimes, cruelty, etc. The virtues like compassion, sharing, self-control are obliterated by the impact of flesh food. If we insist on treating animals more brutally, then our behavior will also become less human and more brutal. I will quote one shayari that what will happen if this animal instincts is so embedded in our heart, what will become of man? Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ko loot kar ghar bhar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Samajh kuch aata nahi kya kar raha hai aadmi. Friends, this is because the man has become an animal. He does not then distinguish between whether he is an animal or a human being, because this is the influence of the food, the flesh food that he eats. Flesh food is the cause of PMS syndrome, that is preposterous mood swing and psychological distortions. Thus, it is now established that if flesh food is the root cause of moral and spiritual degeneration. We at Indian Vegetarian Congress, we are working for important task, since it will lead to a more humane world at peace with animal kingdom and with each other. We at IVC define a vegetarian as one who does not at any time or under any circumstances eat meat, fish, fowl, eggs, or any other type of flesh food. Vegetarian does not come from vegetable. Now, this is very important, friends, understand. The word vegetarian does not come from vegetable. The root is derived from the word vegetus, V-E-G-E-T-U-S, meaning whole, sound, fresh, lively. Nothing is more powerful than an individual acting out of his conscious, thus helping to bring the collective conscious to life. That is what Norman Cousins said. And what does Albert Schweitzer has to say? Until man extends his circle of compassion to all living things, man will not find peace for himself. It is a man's sympathy with all creatures that first makes him truly a human being. Now, friends, I will go next to the most important topic, and that is the medical viewpoint. It's a fallacy, friend. It's a myth to say that we don't get enough protein from veg food. And that is why a man must have flesh food that is rich in protein. I'll come one by one to these myths. First of all, I will first give you examples of those strong animals, say elephant, say rhino. These are the strongest animals on this earth. Are they meat eaters? No. They are pure veg. Even if they die, they will not eat meat. Even then, they are the strongest. Take example of horse. We talk about horse power. It's the most powerful creature useful for our purpose, and that is also a pure vegetarian. And take examples of cattle, cows, bullock, and other animals. They are not only useful to us, but they are pure vegetarian. My point here is that those vegetarian animals are strong enough and they don't need any flesh food. In fact, if stupidly flesh food is given to these veg animals, what will happen? You all know about the mad cow disease, the syndrome called BEC. Friends, this BSE, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, you know what happened a few years back in England? It was a result of feeding rendered sheep byproducts to cattle as protein supplement. These sheep were infected with scrapie, an SE disease known for over 200 years. Now, if sheep food can make a cow mad, what do you expect the result on human being? Millions of innocent cows were killed mercilessly just because they were suspected to be infected with BSE, and that too for no fault of theirs, but the stupid ways of feeding sheep protein on absolutely unnatural diet for a cow. So is the case with humans. Animal protein is not natural for us. Similarly, millions of chicks were destroyed in Eastern Asia countries because they were infected with certain disease. Now coming back to healthy diet, I will quote from one doctor, Dean Ornish, who has written a very learned book on how to reverse heart disease without surgery or drugs. And this book, my friends, is the best seller in America now. It has really created interest in the people of America and all over the world for that matter, that veg food is definitely better from medical point of view. He has given two types of diet, one reversal and one prevention of heart disease. Both are strictly veg diets because he has proved scientifically that veg food is the best food for a human being. It not only helps heart patients, but also reduces risk of other degenerating and fatal diseases caused by flesh food, diseases like cancers of colon, cancers of breast, cancers of prostate, obesity, high blood pressure, stroke, diabetes, gallstones. The Surgeon General of America has confirmed this in the report on nutrition and health. He has given certain facts for protein. Friends, we'll have to be a little technical about it. The protein is formed from building blocks called amino acids. These are of million varieties, of which only three are critical for us: lysine, tryptophan, and methionine. All these are available in animals as well as veg, plant food. But when one consumes animal food for getting these three critical amino acids, one also consumes unnecessary elements like cholesterol, saturated fat. Friends, these are the two things that are the prime reason, the killers for human being: cholesterol and saturated fat. Now let us address the issue that is universally put forward, that we do not get sufficient protein from vegetarian food. And so we have to turn to flesh food for adequate supply of amino acids. Now this is a fallacy. A combined meal of legumes and cereals. Legumes means dal, pulses, and cereals mean wheat, rice, etc. You have to combine these two and you get a complete balanced diet which provides complete protein, which is not different from protein found in eggs or meat, but without cholesterol and animal instincts. One dietic association has stated positive relationship between vegetable lifestyles and risk reduction for several chronic degenerative diseases, as mentioned earlier. It has confirmed that veg diet is healthier and more nutritious. Plant food is totally free from cholesterol, which is only found, which is found in both. But cholesterol is only found in animal products such as meat, poultry, fish, and dairy. Flesh food is also high in saturated fats, which our liver converts into cholesterol. Our body makes all the cholesterol we need. Now, this is very important, friends. You must understand. We need cholesterol, but we don't have to take cholesterol from animal food. Our body, it's a wonderful mechanism. The biochemistry, the chemical factory of our body can manufacture all proteins, all cholesterol from our own system. 3/4 of the cholesterol in our blood is made by our body. It is the excessive amounts of cholesterol and saturated fat in the diet that lead to coronary heart disease. The other diseases, friends, which I have summarized from various journals, medical journals: epilepsy, infected flesh, kidney diseases, excessive protein, excessive uric acid. These are all the diseases because of the flesh food. Rheumatoid, arthritis, gout. This is the direct consequence of uric acid found in flesh food. Degeneration of intestines. Decay in immunity system. Dr. Deepak Chopra of America has stated that our body is capable of living for more than 100 years if we take proper care of it. Now look at the population in North extreme north region Eskimos. Now, perforce, because no vegetation is available, they have to take flesh food. And the average life of an Eskimo is only 30 years. All non-veg food is devoid of vitamin C and vitamin A, which is naturally available in vegetables. Avidin in eggs and other dangerous bacteria are responsible for many skin diseases such as eczema, scabies, leprosy, etc. Now, I'll give you a certain scientific facts. One medical study has proved that there are less heart diseases in veg people than flesh eaters. Second, it's a well-known fact that not only in India, but even in advanced countries, there is no foolproof system of medical exam of animals before slaughtering. Thus, diseases carried by them are passed on to the humans who eat flesh food. Friends, we all know that like human beings, the animals are also infected by diseases. And they are the carriers of the deadliest germs. And when these animals, they die and one eats that flesh, that diseases which were infected and which were the part of the dead body of that animal is again inherited by us. 9% of food poisoning cases, 90% of food poisoning cases are in flesh food eaters. When an animal or bird is brought to a slaughterhouse, now this is a friend which is again, it needs some explanation. If you have visited a slaughterhouse or a poultry, you will know this. When the animals are brought to the slaughterhouse and when they know that they are going to be slaughtered, the pain, the agony, the anguish that runs in the system, it gives rise to adrenaline, the hormones, which mixes with the blood and into the flesh. Now, these instincts of fear, anguish, anger, despair, all negative points are then becoming part of the flesh food and it passes on to the person who eats. And that is why, friends, I say that when one eats flesh food, he becomes more like animal and less like a human being. I will now turn to the fallacy that eggs are necessary for growing children because they contain protein. As I said, excessive protein is more harmful than useful. And the protein that we find in pulses, in cereals, is much more richer and natural than the protein, the excessive protein we find in animal food. Now I'll give you the example of egg. Each egg weighs about 100 grams and has 170 calories. It contains 13.6% of protein, as against that, any dal or pulse will contain 24% of protein, much more than the egg, of same weight, 100 grams. Egg will contain 13.3% saturated fat, while there is no saturated fat or very little of 1% in cereals and pulses. 450 to 500 milligram of cholesterol is contained in egg, one egg. Amino acid called methionine, which destroys vitamin B. Large quantity of sodium salt. All these are part of the egg. And when one eats egg, he is then infected. His body is infected because of this excess protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. It does not contain any carbohydrate. It does not contain any fiber. Friends, the medical science has now come forward and stated that for our digestion, we must have fiber. And fiber is found only in vegetable food and not in the flesh food at all. Now, cost-wise, I'm only comparing the egg now. Cost-wise, for 1 gram of protein, the cost of egg is 4 to 5 times more than the pulses, wheat or soybean. Cost of 100 calories, it is almost 10 times the costlier than the pulses. Thus, pulses, wheat, etc. are not only cheaper, but they provide other important nutritions like vitamins, minerals, fiber, etc. Now, let's take a look at the poultry farming. Now, they call it poultry farming. It's a totally misnomer. I tell you, sir, it is a poultry factory. The way in which the birds are stored there. They have to climb upon one another to eat or drink because there is not sufficient space. Even the poultry people, they say that this is our factory and these are our merchandise. They are goods, nothing but our products. We are not concerned whether they are living beings or not. They are totally devoid of any compassion, any karuna, and that is why these things are also reflected in the birds. The birds are stored like commodities. They are fed unnatural food and administered drugs which are harmful for humans only to speed up their metabolism so that they can produce more eggs. The poultry people are only interested in making profit. And the result of this, they die premature death. It affects physical as well as mental health, intellectual and emotional growth. Egg is poison for children. Egg begin to rot immediately unless they are put in deep fridge. But when they are marketed, they are prone to decay and disease faster. Vegetable egg is again a myth. It's a fallacy. No egg can be a vegetable egg. It's an animal product, an animal product only. It is definitely it's definitely an animal product. It can never be called vegetable item. It's a misnomer. It's a deception. Friends, I will now turn to the economical aspect. Now, these also I have studied from various journals, medical science, and more important, from the statistics department of the government of India and government of America, the UK government, etc. But I will not, that's why, give you the citations during my talk, but I will give you the summary. UK. The survey has stated the land required to produce the fodders to feed the animals to obtain flesh food is 14 times more than that required for vegetable diet to feed men directly. Because what happens? First you grow fodder. You feed it to the animals. And then you kill the animals for flesh food. And that is how you get your flesh food. But if the same land is used for agriculture, for pulses and cereals, that same piece of land can support many more families. And here, only few families can be supported by using this land for pasture. I have been given one statistics. 10 square acres of land can support 10 heads of human beings or 10 heads of cattle for the whole year. 10 heads of cattle for meat cannot support even one single person throughout the year. Natural grass or pasture can, and grain crop both genetically belong to grass family. You see, once the crop is harvested, what we have is sashish or stalks. These are again the source of, excellent source of biochemical fertilizer or manure. Look how many crores of rupees of our foreign exchange we are wasting on artificial fertilizer and chemical fertilizer, which we all know is extremely harmful to us. But because we are not able to get the natural manure which we can get from cattle and animals, we are destroying them, foolishly destroying them for our own food. But we are not considering the fact that the manure that these animals produce are much more economical, much more healthier, and much more useful to our country. It's now a well-known fact that 16 kilogram of food grain are required to be fed to one animal for forming 1 kilogram of meat. Thus, by feeding animals reared for slaughter, the country is deprived of vital food grains which can feed many, many more people. So, not only for growing food, but also for pasture and for manure, we require land. The human oncogene, work done by Professor Wilbing from Massachusetts, it has stated that to obtain 1 calorie of animal flesh, 7 vegetable calories have to be spent. Then the study further shows that the land needed to graze one average animal can sustain 5 average families. I will not burden you with facts and figures, but the summary of all this is that it is very economical to feed people on veg diet rather than on flesh food. Now let's take the other point of view of economy, ecology, environment, slaughterhouses, etc. Production of animal flesh food require more land, more water, more food grains for feeding animals meant for slaughtering. Now this will again destroy or rather disturb the balance of our ecology and environment. Because the resources are always limited, we have to make best use of that. Either we grow crops or we rear animals for slaughtering. And look at the way the slaughterhouses work, how they are maintained. It's simply a hygienic horror. The conditions are appalling and totally unsanitary all over the world. Yesterday only on internet I got a report from foreign countries, advanced countries of America and France, that the conditions of slaughterhouses there also, it is reported, are totally unsanitary. I got a copy of white papers from a government accountability project of America, fighting filth on the kill floor, a matter of life and death for America's families. Slaughtering of animals, meat processing plants, and finally most unhygienic ways of transport and sale of flesh food has made flesh food totally unfit for human consumption. And do not think for a moment that imported, packaged, nicely packaged meat or canned meat is totally hygienic. No, my dear friends, that is also coming from those slaughterhouses where all these things which I have stated of medical science will apply. Not only that, they add certain preservatives, certain chemicals, certain additives which will keep the meat fresh. Environmental consciousness in India and abroad has now driven many people to vegetarianism. Environment-friendly veg foods are now available. The craze now in all over the world is to go for environmental-friendly veg food because it is considered friendly and healthy. The green factories or glass houses are now exporting plant food, including fruits, to those countries which cannot grow them because of climate. The modern transportation system has given a much better alternative for food choice. In fact, for developing nations like India, government and NGOs should give more emphasis on larger production of more exports of plant food, which will serve the economic development of our country. Now look at the pollution. The pollution caused by legal and illegal slaughterhouses is terrific. The discharge of effluents from even so-called modern abattoirs is in the open and exposed to elements and public gaze. The carcasses of animals, the flow of blood, the horrible stench, etc. will add to the pollution. Ecological balance. Utility of animal world for human welfare cannot be overemphasized. Both are interdependent. Cows, sheep, fish, frogs, etc. are much more useful to us alive than dead. Then why should we kill our friends and our helpers to satisfy our taste buds? We should not be so much ungrateful, my friends, to our lesser beings. We call them animals or birds. Look at it from another point of view of natural manure. I have already stated that the animals produce much more natural and healthy manure than the artificial manure. Artificial chemicals, manures cost us dearly. Now again, I'm coming back to our economic term. We are importing artificial chemicals for manure purposes. That is again a drain on our exchequer. Friends, I will now briefly give you historical and geographical views. I have already touched upon it. Historically, in certain dry areas of miles and miles of desert where no vegetable can ever grow, maybe only food or survival was the animal food. Geographically, I stated as like Eskimos, there was no alternative. But once we have got this better alternative, which is healthier, which is more economical, which is more eco-friendly, why not go for such food? And friends, I will now go to the most important point, which will prove my point beyond any doubt that why man is vegetarian by nature. I've got some 16 points here to compare how our body is built up. As Mr. Trivedi has started the ball rolling in this fashion of bovine teeth and non-bovine teeth embedded. Now I will first say about herbivorous. Teeth of herbivorous animals are embedded in the jaws, short, blunt, close to one another. While in carnivorous, they are sharp, pointed, long and conical. The two or four teeth that we have got, like some people say they are like dog animals, they are not for meat eating, but they are found also in apes and chimpanzees, and which are fit for plucking the fruits and eating the fruits. The claws, no sharp nails for herbivorous, they are fit to pluck fruits only, while in carnivorous, the sharp nails helps in tearing apart the prey easily. Jaws, body and parts of our human body will fit, whether it will fit with herbivorous animals or with carnivorous animals. Tongue, the tongue of herbivorous is quite smooth, while that of carnivorous is very rough. Water drinking habit, that's a very important thing. My friend Dr. Paresh Dalal told me, he said that these herbivorous animals, they drink water with lips by suction, while all the carnivorous, they drink the water with tongue, they lap up. We don't do it. We always use our lips. Now come to the length of intestine. Longer intestines are found in herbivorous, about 4 times the body length. This cannot quickly expel the flesh food. While in carnivorous, smaller size of intestine, almost equal to the body length, and helps to expel flesh food before it gets contaminated. Liver and kidney, smaller in proportion in herbivorous, so they are unable to throw out waste material easily. While in carnivorous, liver and kidney are longer in proportion, so they can throw out waste material easily. Digestive system, there is a less hydrochloric acid in digestive system of herbivorous, thus flesh cannot be digested easily, while obviously in carnivorous, the quantum of hydrochloric acid is much more, and that is why they can digest the flesh food. But human being cannot. Salvia. In herbivorous, like human being, the salvia is alkaline and contains phytalin, which helps in digesting carbohydrates found in the grains. While in carnivorous, the salvia is always acidic. The blood pH is alkaline, like human being in herbivorous, and acidic in carnivorous. The blood lipoproteins. Human blood lipoproteins is similar to all herbivorous, while it is not similar to that of carnivorous. Sense is weak. All the senses, particularly the eyesight, is weak in herbivorous and very powerful in carnivorous. Sound, the voice is not herbivorous sound, or even the human sound is not frightening, unless, of course, we can make it now frightening. But by nature, the sound of all herbivorous is mild, while that of carnivorous, like lions and tigers, is very coarse and frightening. And lastly, infants. Normal sight power of right from, see the young ones of herbivorous, right from the moment of birth, they can see very clearly. While all the infants of carnivorous wild animals are blind at least for a week. Now friends, it is for you to justify whether men fit by nature in this category of herbivorous grain eaters or in the category of carnivorous the flesh eaters. Now friends, I will now tell you about certain great persons who condemned flesh food. Looking at the world's history, we find that all great scholars, philosophers, scientists like Einstein, artists like Leonardo da Vinci, poets like Milton, Pope, Shelley, and writers like George Bernard Shaw, and religious leaders, of course, of the world. Now, who are those people? The mathematician, the Pythagoras, the Plutarch, Newton and Einstein, the scientist, Dr. Annie Besant, Reverend Dr. Walter Walsh, George Bernard Shaw, Tolstoy, the Greek philosopher Socrates and Aristotle. They are all enlightened people, and they say, They say that blessed are those with noble qualities of tolerance and compassion, love and non-violence, who are not flesh eaters. Now, friends, I will quote from George Bernard Shaw, which is very famous and widely published. We are living graves of murdered beasts. Listen what he says. We are living graves, moving graves of murdered beasts, slaughtered to satisfy our appetites. Like carrion crows, we live and feed on meat, regardless of the sufferings and the pain. Doctors once advised Bernard Shaw. He was very ill. He said that you must take some meat soup. Bernard Shaw said, I'll prefer death than to have anything with flesh food. And believe me, friends, he survived, and the doctor turned vegetarian. In the similar way, Mahatma Gandhi, his son was very sick. He was advised meat soup, and he refused, and the son survived. Why I'm telling you, friends, all these things? That Mr. Trivedi said, yes, medically, whatever the doctor says, we have to accept, no doubt. But as I said in the very first thing, in the beginning I said, everything is relative. When doctor says something, he will say only from medical point of view. And friends, we are not living here. We are here on this earth, not only to survive. Survival is important, but not at the cost of others and inflict pain on others. Thank you very much, friends. 21st century will belong to vegetarians. Okay, I think I have made my points on very general terms, friends. I will tell you that I know those who are regularly flesh eaters are coming from some culture, some family, some faith, and that is why they have never applied their mind. And that is what Mr. Trivedi stated, that we are here today. We have gathered here. Let us apply our mind, that not only from religious angle or from our social angle, because I have seen, I'm not afraid to say, that many of our Jain friends, when they go to certain gatherings, because they are afraid of the social status, they start eating meat. I don't like that. But then it is for everybody, whether he is a vegetarian or a non-vegetarian. Apply your mind. Try to see from all these angles whether it is permitted or prohibited from our own health point of view, from the national point of view, from the social point of view, from ecological, from environmental, and above all, from compassion point of view. Friends, when nature has created all animals, all humans, all creatures equal, nobody has got right to kill anybody just to satisfy his own palates. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Zakir Naik to present his talk.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Ala Rasulillah. Wa ala ali wa sahbi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Awfu bil uqud. Uhillat lakum bahimatul anam illa ma yutla alaykum. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Respected Mr. Ishmael Zaveri, Mr. Trivedi, Dr. Muhammed Naik, the respected people on the dais, my respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this morning's debate is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? It is not whether vegetarian food or non-vegetarian food which is healthy, or which is better. If I prove that an apple is better than a mango, that doesn't mean mango is prohibited. This statement is sufficient to end the dialogue for me, but I have to reply. Non-vegetarian, by definition, means
a person who has food of animal origin. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetarian food. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetables and fruits. Let it be very clear to all of you. A more technical and a scientific word is an omnivorous diet. A person who has many types of food, especially foods of plant and animal origin. Vegetarian, as Mr. Rashmi has very rightly said, it doesn't come from the word vegetables. It comes from vegetas, which means full of breath, full of life. He didn't give a better explanation. We can talk about it. And he didn't speak. There are various types of vegetarian. We have fructarian, who only eat fruits and nuts. Then we have the vegans, who don't have any animal products. We have lacto-vegetarian, what I believe Mr. Ishmael Zavir is. They have milk. We have the ovo-vegetarians, who have eggs. We have the lacto-ovo-vegetarian, who have egg and milk also. We have the pesco-vegetarian who eat fish. We have semi-vegetarian who also have chicken. This classification is done by the Vegetarian Society, not by me. And you can name another 20. Time doesn't permit me. I would like to state a quotation by Dr. William T. Jarvis. Dr. William T. Jarvis, he is the advisor to the American Council of Science and Health, ACSH. And he's also the professor of public health and preventive medicine in the Loma Linda University. And he's also the founder and the president of the National Council Against Health Frauds. And he's the co-editor of the book, The Health Robbers, A Closer Look at Quackery in America. Most of the quotations are from America. And according to him, he classifies vegetarian based on the behavior standpoint into two categories. Pragmatic vegetarian and ideological vegetarian. A pragmatic vegetarian chooses his diets on objective health reasons. He is more reasonable in his approach rather than emotional. The ideological vegetarian, on the other hand, he chooses his diet based on a principle, which is based on an ideology. He is more emotional rather than reasonable. And Dr. William P. Jarvis says, one can spot an ideological vegetarian by his exaggerations of the benefits of vegetarianism. And you could see that in the talk which preceded my talk. Exaggeration of benefits of vegetarianism and the lack of skepticism and the overlooking of the fact that extreme vegetarianism can lead to potential health risks. He says that the ideological vegetarian, he pretends to be like a scientist, but he's more like a lawyer than like a scientist. And you could see that in the talk by the learned speaker. More like a lawyer than like a scientist. They gather data and information selectively against the information which is against the ideology. This may be good for a debate like the one we're having, but not for engendering scientific understanding. Dr. William T. Jarvis says that ideological vegetarianism is filled with hypotheses. It is filled with extremism, from which even scientists and doctors are not immune. And that you can see the quotation. Mr. Rashmi Zaveri has said several diseases. And it's possible for me to refute each and every, but if time permits. Talking about science, but the approach was not scientific. All can be prevented very well. Prevention is better than cure, is the base of the medicine, which time will not permit me to go into health reasons, etc. In the rebuttal, if time permits, I'll try and cover most of the other aspects. And health, I will try and cover in the rebuttal. Let's analyze the various reasons why a person chooses a food habit. It can be religious. It can be geographical location. It can be personal choice, smell, taste, color. Due to humane or ethical consideration. Due to anatomical and physiological consideration, due to behavioral consideration. It can be due to ecological and economical consideration. It can be due to nutritional value or due to health and scientific reasons. Health and medical reasons. Let's first analyze the religious reasons. Mr. Trivedi said that religion should not interfere with the human beings where it's concerned what we should eat and what we should not eat. That you should leave it up to the doctors. I agree with him that most of the religions, that is the case. The religious authorities, the main foundation that's Almighty God, if he's not a doctor, the God that you worship is not a doctor, then you should not follow him. He says leave it to the doctors. But in Islam, we believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, is our creator. And the creator of the human beings has far superior knowledge than all the doctors put together in all the years. And you can find the statements, as Mr. Ishmael already said, all from doctors. He's quoting from these books, which I think is available for sale outside, all these books. I will touch on some of these points, all out of which many are fictitious. Fictitious don't exist at all. Some are irrelevant, some are untested, and some are truths, which are half-baked truths. I would like to make one point crystal clear. That while I prove undoubtedly that non-veg food should be permitted for the human beings, I do not have the slightest intention to hurt the feelings of any vegetarians. And while I prove logically and scientifically that non-veg food is permitted, and if someone feels hurt, his sentiments are hurt, I apologize in advance. I sincerely apologize. My intention is not to hurt anybody's feeling, but I have to reply to the presentation of the earlier speaker. As far as Islam is concerned, it is not compulsory for a human being to have non-veg. A Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. But, when our Creator, Almighty God Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives us permission to have non-veg, why should we not have it? And I started my talk by giving a quotation from the glorious Quran, from Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 1, which says, Ya ayyuhal ladzina amanu, O you believe, awfu bil ukud, uhillat lakum bahimatul anam, illa ma yutla alaykum. Fulfill all your obligations. And lawful for you for food are all four-footed animals with the exceptions named. Quran further says in Surah Al-Hil, chapter number 16, verse number 5, that cattle has been created by God for you. In it are various benefits. You derive warmth, and of the meat you can eat. The same message is repeated in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 21, that you can have the meat of the cattle. Let's analyze the geographical reasons and the surrounding environment. And as we know, it influences a person's food habit. Like people living in the coastal region, the Konkanis, they have more fish. People living in South India, they have more rice. People living in the deserts, where the scarcity of vegetation, people mainly survive on the flesh of animals. The Eskimo, the Arctic region, where there's scarcity of edible vegetation, they survive more on seafood. And Mr. Zaveri said that he knows that vegetable is not available in certain parts of the world, but today, due to advancement of transportation, we can supply them with vegetables. I would request the Indian Vegetarian Congress to supply, at least give the transportation cost, that's all, to supply to the Eskimos, to supply to Saudi Arabia. You get vegetables in Saudi Arabia, it is more expensive. Why? Because the cost of transportation. That makes it more expensive. It is illogical and unscientific to spend more money to buy a food which is less nutritious. Let's analyze the humane reasons, the ethical reasons, and the pure vegetarians, they say that all life is sacred, and no living creature should be killed, they failed to realize that today it's a universal fact that even plants have got life. So the main argument on killing living creature doesn't hold good today. Previously, maybe. A couple of centuries ago, it may have held some weight, but today it carries no weight. Then they further argue today and they say, yes, we know that plants have got life, but they can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser crime and lesser sin as compared to killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and we have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. They can even cry. But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human ear because the audible frequency range of the human ear is from 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this, the human ear can't hear. But the cry of the animal can be heard by the human beings, but the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human beings. Just because you cannot hear the cry of the plant, that doesn't justify you to inflict pain or kill the plant. There was an ideological vegetarian who had a discussion with me. He told me that, Brother Zakir, I know that plants have life. They feel pain. But you know, plants, they have got about 2 senses less as compared to the animals. I said, for sake of argument, I agree with you. But then I asked him a simple question. That suppose your brother is born deaf and dumb. Cannot hear, cannot speak. 2 senses less. And when he grows up, and when someone comes and murders him, will you go and tell the judge, oh me Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had 2 senses less? In fact, you will say, usne to masoom ko mara hai. He has killed an innocent person. Give him a bigger punishment. And further, if you analyze that in Islam, as far as living creatures are concerned, there are 2 types, broadly classified 2 types. Human beings who are living creatures and non-human being living creatures. As far as killing the human beings are concerned, Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, that if any person, if anyone, kills any human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading mischief in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole nation. If any person kills any human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief, Quran says he has killed the whole of humanity. If you save any human being, you have saved the whole of humanity. As far as non-human being living creatures are concerned, no human being should harm them unnecessarily, should not kill them unnecessarily for sports or for fun or for target practice. But if it is for your security and for your safety, you can stop them, you can even kill them. Or if you want for lawful food, but not just for fun and frolic or for hunting. Even if I agree that the plants are a lesser species as compared to the human beings, if you take the life of one animal, an average animal, it can feed about 100 human beings. For the same 100 human beings, you may have to kill more than 100 plants. So is it preferable to take the life of one living animal or the life of 100 living plants? Which is a bigger sin? Is it a bigger sin to kill 100 human beings who are handicapped or kill one healthy human being? Which is a bigger sin? You decide for yourself. There is a vegetarian society by the name of World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. Most of the quotation which he gave is from here and from these 3 books, most of them, almost all. The name of the foundation is World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. They forgot to mention except plant life in bracket. And it says, all creation is one family. All life is sacred. What kind of an ideology is this that you permit the killing of one family member, but do not permit the killing of the other family member It's illogical and unscientific. You know, in America, there are vegetarian society who take students to slaughterhouses and they make them see the bloodshed and convert them to vegetarianism. It is like a doctor taking the young girls to observe and watch a difficult childbirth and then say, that's the reason you should not marry and should not have children. These are unethical forms of mind control. Unethical. Unethical. In fact, we should teach our children that when vegetables can be grown for food, why can't animals be raised for food? All life is sacred. I agree. Unnecessary killing them is wrong. But for a requirement, lawful food is permitted. Let's analyze the anatomical and the behavioral consideration. And there were a list of various things mentioned by Mr. Zaveri. You know, he was reading from paper at 100 miles per hour, asking, note down. How many disease? I, being a medical doctor, can answer, but how much can answer? To name 10 disease will take few seconds. To reply all 10 will take more than an hour. And he listed a lot. I'll just try and tell you that if you go to authentic books, not researches made by ideological vegetarians, most of the answers are given on the medical aspect. Considering the anatomical and the physiological aspect, and rightly said that if you observe the teeth of the herbivorous animal, the cow, the goat, the sheep, they have a flat set of teeth. They only have vegetables. If you observe the teeth of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, they have pointed set of teeth. They only have animal flesh, not non-veg, animal flesh. They are not called as non-veg animals. They are called as carnivorous animals. There's a difference between carnivorous and non-veg. Non-veg actually is omnivorous. But if you analyze the set of teeth of the human beings, we have got flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. If Almighty God, our Creator, wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us these pointed teeth? For what? And Mr. Zaveri said, these pointed teeth, they are not referring to the dog. They refer to the apes. He doesn't know the scientific meaning of the word canine. Comes from the root word caninus in Latin, which means of dog. And canine means pertaining to the family of Canida, like wolves, dogs, etc. Scientists have given this name. Canine, meaning pertinent to dog. And he said, it doesn't look like the teeth of dogs. It refers to teeth of apes and monkeys. I believe in agreeing with the argument and proving my point, then you disprove him. It's easy. Even if I agree, it is the teeth like the monkeys. Do you know monkeys also have non-veg? They have the lice. There are many species of ape who even have raw flesh of animals. Many species of apes who have raw flesh. They're omnivorous. Who says they're carnivorous? They're omnivorous. They aren't pure veg also. And many species are even called as cannibals. Some species of apes and monkeys. If you analyze the digestive system of the human being, it can digest both veg as well as non-veg. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us a digestive system which can digest both veg as well as non-veg? And Mr. Zaveri said that we cannot have raw flesh. I agree with him, most human beings cannot have raw flesh. In the same way, most of the human beings cannot have raw vegetables, raw vegetarian diet, like raw wheat, raw rice. Can you have it? Raw moong, raw drumstick. Can you have? You'll get indigestion. So what is the argument? No, you have to cook them. I know as a medical doctor that raw wheat, raw rice, raw drumstick, if you have, you'll have problems. You can't digest them. So you have to cook them. Similarly with the flesh, we non-vegetarians, we cook them for easy digestion. But yet, there are certain human beings who even have raw meat. He gave the name of Eskimos. He didn't tell the root word meaning. The root word meaning of Eskimo, it literally means eaters of raw flesh. So there are human beings who even have raw meat. They're conditioned. Tomorrow, if you're conditioned to eat raw wheat and raw rice, even you may be able to digest it. But most human beings cannot digest certain raw vegetables. That doesn't mean you should not have rice, you should not have wheat, that you should not have drumsticks. There are, in the herbivorous animal, an enzyme known as cellulase enzyme. And every vegetable has cellulase. And this cellulase enzyme helps in digesting the vegetables. We human beings, we don't have cellulase enzymes. Therefore, the vegetables we eat, the cellulose part remains undigested, and we call them as fibers. It's undigested. On the other hand, there are certain enzymes like lipase, trypsin, chemotrypsin, which are mainly meant for digesting non-vegetarian food. If Almighty God did not want us to have non-veg food, why did he give us these enzymes? And the primitive man, as said by the earlier speaker as well as the chief guest, archaeological evidence shows us clearly the Homo sapiens, the Eskimos, the Austrian Aborigines, they were non-veg. So why the change now? We have the same teeth, we have the same digestive system, and he has given a list of other comparison which prove we can have veg. And I agree with that. Where did I ever say that you cannot have veg? A non-veg is a person who has the food of the animal products as well as vegetarian food. It's an omnivorous diet. He said that the liver and the kidney in carnivorous animal is large. In the human beings, it is small like the herbivorous, because the animals have raw meat. Therefore, they have to remove the toxin on a higher level. We do it by cooking the food. Therefore, God gave us a small kidney and a small liver, which is sufficient to digest both cooked non-veg and also vegetables. Similarly, with all the arguments, HCl, it's not very acidic. Why? Because we don't require it. If you don't require it, why should God unnecessarily give it to us? Same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. All the arguments are that because they have raw flesh, therefore they require it. We don't require it. So why should God give us? Yes, it's required for digesting veg food and cooked non-veg food. He said, carnivorous animals, they lick. And the herbivorous animals, they sip. We human beings, we do both. We do both. When we drink, while we drink, we sip. When we have ice cream, what do? We lick. We lick also, and we sip also, depending upon what is the food we are eating. Even the tea we can lick, not that we can't lick. But why do we waste time? It will take more time. Similar with all the arguments he's given about the teeth being closed. Because we also have vegetables. If God would have asked us not to have vegetables, then maybe the teeth were far apart. He asked us to have both non-veg as well as veg food. And there are various verses in the Quran talking about various foods, pomegranate, talking about vegetables, talking about dates, etc., which we should have. The plants, many vegetarians say, that they regrow. Therefore, we aren't killing the plant, and there are some plants which have that facility, not all plants. There are various, which we cut, it regrows. So if this is the only argument, that because it regrows, you can have veg food, you know, if you cut the tail of the lizard, it regrows. Will you have the tail of the lizard? It's a delicacy. There are human beings, the Austrian Aborigines, they relish the lizard. Will you have the tail of the lizard? And the answer will be no. You know what I'm doing now? I'm behaving like a lawyer. I'm feeling ashamed to answer all these things, but I have to do, because it is also a debate. I had come here so that we understand better and have a friendly understanding of each other, but I have to behave like a lawyer also, besides being logical and scientific, because the arguments put forth, anyone who has general knowledge can reply. But because people don't have general knowledge, many people aren't aware. That's why these arguments may satisfy many people. And all these arguments are given in the books, which are distributed, Meat Eating, 100 Facts by Nemi Chan, distributed by Jain organization, also by the Indian Vegetarian Congress. This is a book given to me by Mr. Zaveri. 100 facts about egg, vegetarian or non-vegetarian. Each and every argument can be disproved. Certain things I know that non-veg causes diseases which can be prevented. Let's analyze the behavioral consideration. He gave certain arguments. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. I agree with him to a certain level. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. That's the reason we Muslims have the flesh of herbivorous animal like goat, sheep, who are docile and peace-loving. We want to be peace-loving and docile. We don't have the meat of the carnivorous animal like lion, tiger, dog, pig, etc. And the Prophet clearly says all these animals are prohibited. We are peace-loving people. Therefore, we want to have animals which are peaceful. And countering argument, you all eat plants and you all behave like plants. That is suppression of the senses. A lower species. I know scientifically it is wrong. I'm only behaving like a lawyer. I feel ashamed to speak these points as a medical doctor. It's not true that you eat plants, you behave like plants. But the argument he has put forth, I'm giving a counter reply. You eat plants and you behave like plants, weak and suppressed, can't move properly. I'm sorry. I really apologize. I have to reply to the arguments. I apologize if I've hurt the feeling of any vegetarian. It is not scientifically true. It's just an argument, a counter argument. Further, he gave the list of various peace-loving people like Mahatma Gandhi, and I respect Mahatma Gandhi because he has done certain good things for India and humanity. But if, because Mahatma Gandhi was peaceful, indicates that if you have veg food makes you peaceful, then today if you analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners for peace, almost all or most of them are non-vegetarian. Menachem Begin, non-veg. Yasser Arafat, non-veg. Anwar Sadat, non-veg. Mother Teresa, non-veg. Mother Teresa. I want to ask you a simple question. Which man in the history of humankind is known maximum for killing maximum human beings? Can you guess? Hitler! Adolf Hitler! He has killed 6 million Jews. Was he a non-veg or veg? Vegetarian! Anyhow, there are crusaders of vegetarians. You know, now on the internet if you go, they say, see, Adolf Hitler was a vegetarian is a myth. He sometimes had non-veg. And the other side says that, you know, when he had gastric problems, that time he had vegetable foods only. To tell you frankly, on a scientific viewpoint, I do not consider the diet of Hitler to be responsible for him killing 6 million Jews. Neither am I telling, irrespective whether you are a vegetarian or non-vegetarian, I'm not interested in knowing, because I, being a doctor, I know it doesn't carry any weight. There were other factors which influenced him to take this drastic step, which is totally inhumane, not the diet. There are various researches done. There have been researches in America on a group of students who are pure non-veg and on a group of students who are veg, pure veg. And they analyze that the group of students who were non-veg, they were less violent and they were more social. But it's a research. It's not a scientific fact. I will never use this as an argument to prove that non-veg food makes you peaceful. No. I'm a doctor, more of a doctor, as well as lawyer where required because I'm in a debate. There are researches, but these researches aren't scientific facts. Most of the statements what Mr. Rashmi Zaveri made, all were researches, not scientific facts. There is not a single authentic medical book which says that non-veg food in general should be prohibited. Not a single. All these are researches, like the research done by this person in America. Then they say that veg food makes a person intelligent. And he gave a list of great names, Albert Einstein and Isaac Newton, etc., etc. if we analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners in all these years, majority were non-veg, majority. And today, animal behavioral scientists, they say that the carnivorous animal should be more intelligent than the herbivorous animal in order to catch the prey. If he's not intelligent, how will he catch the prey? But anyway, I'm not going to use this as an argument, therefore non-veg food makes you intelligent, because these things don't actually affect a human being. The diet does affect a human being, but these arguments don't affect. These arguments don't affect. And all the other arguments given, they don't carry weight, actually. There are people who give examples that non-veg food makes you strong is a myth. It's a scientific fact mentioned in several medical books, authentic, that non-veg food is good for health. It does have disease also, you can prevent them. There are proteins, which I'll come to it later on. And to counter-argue that, they're giving an example of Yadunath Singh Naik. Has anyone heard of him? Yadunath Singh Naik. In the army, it is mentioned in this book, vegetarian or non-vegetarian, choose yourself, by Gopinath Agarwal. Yadunath Naik, being a vegetarian in the army, in wrestling, he defeated two non-vegetarians. Therefore, veg food makes you strong. I feel ashamed to reply to these arguments. I feel ashamed. It's a known fact that the title holders of world wrestling, yes, there are vegetarian wrestlers also, but if you compare with the full world, almost all the title holders of world wrestling are non-veg. The person known in bodybuilding maximum, who is he? Arnold Schwarzenegger, 13 times world titles he got. 7 as Mr. Olympia, 5 as Mr. Universe, and 1 as Mr. World. What was he, veg or non-veg? Non-veg. The boxer Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay, non-veg. Mike Tyson, non-veg. Yes, of course, non-veg food does add to the strength. That is a scientific fact. That's the reason that if you analyze, that when a person is convalescing from a disease, it's preferable non-veg food. Not that you have to have non-veg, it's preferable egg, etc. And I'll come to it later on. And then they give an example of a wrestler, Professor Ram Murthy. Never heard his name. He says it's a world famous wrestler. Who has heard of him? Anyone has heard of him? Professor Ram Murthy? No one. World famous. Where do you get this news from? World famous. Then they give the example of Paramjit Singh in London, pure vegetarian, who skips 2,000 times a day. Therefore, vegetarian food makes you an athlete. If these are the arguments supposed to be scientific, I really feel ashamed. Most of the athletic record holders, here's the Guinness book. You can go through it. I've brought it along here. All mentioned about bodybuilding, athletic, 100 meters dash, all these people. If at random also you check up their dietary history, even giving benefit of doubt, more than 80 to 90% will be non-veg. But I will be a fanatic if I say that all these records are only due to the diets. I'll be a fanatic. A few records may be related to the diet, but not all. For the argument they give that the smell and the sight of a carnivorous animal is strong. The night vision is strong. As Mr. Rashmi Ajavari said, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivorous. In herbivorous, it is less. In human meat, it is less. Therefore, we should be vegetarian. There are herbivorous animals, like the bee, whose sense of smell is very strong. And they even have a very good night vision. See, these are arguments which are not scientific, may be useful in a debate to convince the people illogically. Therefore, I'm here. Then he gave the example. You know, animals have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice, the carnivorous animal. Herbivorous animal don't have coarse voice. And to ask a simple question, which animal is maximum known for a hoarse voice? Donkey. Veg or non-veg? Veg or non-veg? Veg. Anyway, by no means am I trying to prove that vegetarian food creates hoarse voice or non-vegetarian food creates melodious voice. If you see the list of singers, many are non-veg, many are veg also. So just by quoting singers who are veg saying, oh, that's why vegetarian diet makes you melodious, is all illogical arguments. Really, I feel ashamed to answer all these things. And he gave certain economic points, that economic reasons why we should have vegetarian food. It's more economical, according to Mr. Zaveri. And he gave several statistics, so many calories, so many this, so many tons of protein, which is mentioned here. From where they get the statistics, God alone knows. And he mentioned some protein. It's also mentioned in this book that 1 kg of animal protein that we get, we have to feed so many plants, etc. Therefore, it's equivalent to 7 kg of veg protein. So if you're having meat for 1 kg protein, you are taking 7 kg vegetables. Therefore, vegetable is cheaper. How they get this kg of protein, I being a medical doctor, don't realize. Is it kg of food or kg of protein? And if I agree with them, I agree with them. Okay. You say, for sake of argument, 2 + 2 = 5, I agree, and then ask you, let's see, take 2 rupees, give me 5 rupees. Take 2,000, give me 5,000. Similarly, if I agree it is right, all the statistics, then I tell that the vegetarians, they should thank the non-vegetarians. You know why? Because if we would not have slaughtered the animal for food, it would have lived for another 5 to 10 years. And in that time, you'd have had the vegetables of 7 to 8 people for a few years. So you should thank us from preventing the animal from eating your vegetable food. Furthermore, he gave the calculation from some record, from where, I don't know. 1:14, the land that you graze required for animal is 14 times more than the land required for food, etc. Same example is given here, that the land required to produce 1 ton of beef, the same land you can feed 5 average families. 1 ton of beef is equivalent to 10 or 20 tons of veg food. And the land required to graze an animal can raise 5 average families. My early argument also holds good here. But besides that, these ideological vegetarians, they fail to realize that the animals graze on land which is unsuitable for growing crops. They eat the plants which is inedible for the human beings, like husk and stalks, corn stalks. They don't eat plants which are edible for the human beings. Yes, they can eat. But when they enter the fields, the farmer, but natural, takes them out of the field. Why? To cause loss. Yes, if you have excess of crop, etc., there are certain governments who even feed them. And there are nomadic populations who make their living by grazing animals on land which is unsuitable for crop growing. But they eat the vegetation which is inedible to the human beings, and they make their living. Even the animal lives, even the human being lives. And today, according to UN report, about 23% approximately of the land in the world is used for pastures, 23% for forest, less than 10% for cultivation. The remaining 45% majority can yet be used for growing crops. Why don't you use that? Why are you running after the food of the animals, poor living creatures? Let them live, let them eat. Why are you stopping them from eating? If the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Overpopulation. I'm aware that human beings, they raise animals for food. That means by methods, they increase the multiplication of animals. But if suppose I agree that from today, all non-vegetarians stop raising animals for food and stop killing them for food, yet they will grow in population. You know why? Human beings. In all these years, our population is increasing. Even with all the family planning method, with all the birth control, hamdo hamare do, yet we are increasing. There is no birth control method among the cattle,
and the gestation is less than the human beings. 5 months to 6 months to 8 months. Less than the human beings. And they multiply faster. So if we stop killing and stop raising yet, within a few decades, you'll have problems not of overpopulation of human beings, of overpopulation of cattle. How are we going to solve it? There are various nutrition. He talked about protein, etc. If time permits, I will speak in the rebuttal. I would like to make a statement of Dr. George R. Kerr, which is sufficient to counter all his arguments on health. Dr. George R. Kerr, he is the professor of nutrition in the University of Texas. Why I'm giving the designation, you can come to know that these people actually specialize in catching health fraud. People who deal in fraud in health. He says that virtually all authors of the diet and disease books, they propose hypotheses which are untested, ill-tested, unfound, unlikely, or disproved. I would like to repeat. Dr. George R. Kerr says, virtually all authors of books on diet and disease, they propose hypotheses which is ill-tested, unfound, non-tested, unlikely, or disproved. Time is running short. I would like to make the statement that's given by the American Council on Science and Health. Just a statement. See, they are experts. These quotation of research and scientific facts, all this quotation that this causes this disease, that some are scientific facts, but they can be prevented. But the other thing was mentioning about this land and that land, these are only statistics done by individual researchers. Even when you do PhD, you can do a research and that will come into account, but won't carry weight. American Council on Science and Health says that a person need not abstain from meat and be a vegetarian to have a healthy diet. And the topic is not veg or non-veg, which is healthier. It is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for the human beings? And I will list out the points in summary to make it easier for Mr. Zaveri to answer in the rebuttal. Point number one, there is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. Point number two, geographical places like Arctic, Eskimos live. How could you have provided food all these years back? And today also, if you provide, it's going to be more expensive. Point number three, if all life is sacred, why do you kill the plants? Even they have life. Point number four, even plants feel pain. Point number five, even if I agree they have two senses less, killing a creature of two senses less is a lesser crime, is illogical. Point number six, it's preferable to kill one animal and take one animal life than to take 100 lives of plants for feeding 100 people.
Point number seven,
each and every argument can be disproved. The liver and the kidney, HCl, same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. Point number eight, the human beings have an omnivore set of teeth for eating veg as well as non-veg. Point number nine, they have a digestive system which can digest both veg and non-veg and have proved it scientifically, have proved by the enzymes. Point number 10, primitive man was non-veg. So you can't say it's prohibited for human beings. Human beings means even for that person. Point number 11, the food you eat has an effect on your behavior, but saying that non-veg food makes you violent has got no scientific base at all. Point number 12, giving argument that veg food makes you strong, makes you peaceful, makes you intelligent, makes you athletes, are all myths. Point number 13, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivores. In herbivores, it is less. The carnivorous animal have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice. Herbivorous animal don't have coarse voice, are all illogical arguments. Point number 14, that veg food is cheaper, I've disproved it. It's not economical. In certain countries, yes. Like India, it can be. But if you go abroad, in the Western countries, veg food is more expensive. And fresh veg food is phenomenal.
fresh vegetables. Furthermore, point number 15, that the land required to graze the animal will cause scarcity of the land for growing crops is also wrong. Point number 16, if the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Point number 17, according to Dr. Kerr, these books written by dietitian, they can't be relied upon. All the statistics given are mainly from there. There is not a single statement, point number 18, in any authentic medical book which says non-veg food in general should be banned. Point number 19, there is not a single government on the face of the earth which has banned all non-veg food as a general rule. And point number 20, that even the American Council on Science and Health has said that for a healthy diet, being a pure vegetarian is not required. These are sufficient proof, logical and scientific, that non-veg food has to be permitted. If Mr. Zaveri doesn't agree, I request him to answer scientifically, not by comparison on just researches. But yet, if Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri doesn't reply to more than 20 points which I've put forth, yet I will not ask him to become a non-veg, because I'm not a fanatic non-vegetarian. I'm not. Yet if you want to continue eating vegetarian food, I have got no objection. It's a personal choice. It's a personal choice. Some people like due to certain taste, etc. It's a personal choice. And only thing I'd like to tell the people, that the vegetarians, the ideological vegetarians who do so much propaganda that this has got more value, etc., they should stop such things and stop distributing these type of books which mislead the people. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 125, which says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikma wal ma'izatil hasna wajadun billati ahsan." That is, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.